We are kind of finishing up our series on the Lord's Prayer, and we're going to bring that kind of to a conclusion today. So before we get into that, I just ask that we would bow and have a moment of prayer together before we get into His Word. Father in heaven, we just thank You for who You are and the very fact that You are in heaven. And yet here we are talking with You, and we thank You that we can come to You in heaven, in our words, through prayer, and in our songs. We thank You that we can come to You this day with both aching hearts and also with hearts full of joy. We are a people here that know that it is all about your kingdom, and that Your kingdom rules and reigns in our lives. And we know that Your will is being done because You are holy and You are most powerful. We seek to be kingdom people that would be a part, an active part in that kingdom, fulfilling Your purpose here and now. We also want for so little, because you've provided so much for all of us. We have, for the most part, we have safety, and we have homes, and we have food, and we have school, and we have work, and we have each other. And we know all good things come from You. And we thank You for that. But we also know that what we really need isn't just that kind of stuff that helps sustain our lives, but we know our spirits need that sustenance that we know comes from Your Son. And we get to know Your Son more fully through prayer and through Scripture. We pray that we would be a people who's empowered to forgive, because You have forgiven us. And Lord, because we're humans, all of us, we know that we are constantly being pulled to steer away from You and Your goodness. And we pray for Your protection and Your power that would guide us in Your path. We just finally pray, Lord, that You would find joy in what we do here, that would be bringing You glory to Your powerful kingdom. These things we pray in Jesus' name, amen. So yeah, we're studying the Lord's Prayer, and if you picked maybe one thing up out of the passage, you know, we do typically recite the Lord's Prayer together, the King James kind of version of that prayer. We do it just about every week. We say it together. But if there's one thing that maybe you've picked up, is that, you know, it's not just the intention of that prayer. When Christ taught His disciples to pray, you know, He did not say, okay, now say these words specifically and do it together every time you pray. That's not what He said. He said, you know, the disciples asked Him, hey, Jesus, teach us how to pray, because they saw how much prayer was so important to Him and the power that seemed to come through Christ's life through prayer. Teach us to pray. And so before He gave them that prayer, He said, pray in this manner, or pray like this. Don't just say these words, but rather, This is a model for by which you should pray. I don't know if you caught it, but I tried to, as we just opened in prayer, but I tried to do just that. You know, I took that outline of the prayer that first and foremost highlights God, of where He is, and the fact that we can address Him. And we talked about His kingdom that's coming and His will. And we talked about daily bread and forgiveness and to not be led into temptation. That was the model by which that prayer that we opened with. And, you know, I'm kind of finding that model, it is, you know, we could pray any way we want to, but I encourage you to try that sometime, where you think about that Lord's Prayer as a model by which you pray. You know, oftentimes in the morning I'll get up early and I take off for a walk by my place. You know, we've had some awesome mornings this week. It's just been beautiful early in the morning, and it's just a great time for me just to have some quiet time and some worship time. And I was kind of thinking through, you know, this and what we've been talking about, and I consciously did that twice. You know, I kind of went through the Lord's Prayer twice. Once just was a, you know, it was just kind of a general prayer for kind of me specifically as I was praying to Him, and I, you know, probably walked down there, had a smile on my face. Cars are probably going by and wonder, what the deuce is that guy doing? He's, you know, he's smiling, and it was just a neat experience. And then I went through it a second time again in this manner, or as this outline, and I prayed for us as a church.
And each of those things that were outlined there, it was easy for me to just think about this church and the direction of this church and the people in this church. And it was just, I got to tell you, it was just a neat, wonderful worship experience. I strongly encourage you to do that. You know, if you're a person who struggles in prayer, you know, we can go right to the throne anytime we want to and just talk to him. But if you do struggle, you can use this as a model in your prayer life. So we're at the end of this prayer as we sort of find it in the Bible. This last part that's called the doxology, which is, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." And you know, we prayed, our opening prayer as we did the responsive was to highlight some of those things that are drawn from that part of the prayer. And the two hymns we sang, I selected those this week because it's talking about God's glory and his power. And that's why, even though they were difficult to sing, that's why they were selected today. "For yours is the kingdom, yours is the power, and yours is the glory forever." You know, if you've ever been at a meal, you know, where there's people from a lot of different faiths, Christian faiths, and, you know, it happens sometimes that, you know, before we eat the meal, we'll say the Lord's Prayer in unison. You know, we'll do that sometimes. It just brings everybody together. But if you're like me, once in a while, you do that. And by the time I get done, I look up and those Catholics are already halfway through their salad. And the reason for that is they don't have that part of the Lord's Prayer in the Lord's Prayer. "For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever." It's not included in the Catholics' Lord's Prayer. It's not there. In fact, if you look in your Bibles, it's kind of difficult to find it. Because if you go to Matthew, in fact, I got the two versions that are up there. You're probably most typical of finding something. I use the NRSV. You're probably, a lot of you I know, use the NIV, the New International Version. And verse 13 is just, "And do not bring us in the time of trial, but rescue us from evil." And it stops right there. But you got to go to the King James Version in Matthew, and there you see where we normally read, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." And there you see it, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." It shows up in that translation of the Bible. So not all people include that in their prayer. That's why the Catholics get to start eating earlier than us. The reason for that is, if I understand this correctly, some of the older copies that we have, the older texts that we have of the Bible, they don't include that part in Matthew's gospel. But yet we do know that doxology was used pretty regularly in the very early church. So it was already there. But from a scripture perspective, there's probably more evidence that would support the fact that Jesus probably didn't say that in teaching his disciples to pray. So, you know, why is it included in some Bibles, and why do some faith systems include it? You know, we're never going to know that answer completely. There's just these questions that scholars are trying to answer. It's kind of like trying to solve a mystery. You've got some information, but yet there's not enough there to complete it. You know, why is it in some and why isn't it in others? It's kind of mysterious. It's really not that different. We had a mystery in our community just recently, and this happened. There's some evidence there, but you kind of got to piece together the rest of the story. And so, you know, I'll share with you some of the information. How would you piece it together? And here's the piece here. And I was very careful to blur out, just to make sure that we didn't offend any of the innocent people that are here, carefully. But this happened in Roanoke, Indiana. This is no doubt. And so you have a little bit of information here. You've got a questionable looking person here that's holding an alligator. And that's real, and you can obviously tell there's peace lights going on in the back. And so here's a little bit of information, and you are the detectives, and you got to solve the mystery. How is it you would solve it? What would your conclusion be? Well, you know, mine. Here's mine. It's probably some shady cowboy wannabe local who has no regard for some animals like white-tailed deer and black bears, but yet seems to be attempting a new reptilian lives matter movement. I got permission to do that beforehand. So point being, you know, yeah, sometimes it is difficult to piece together stuff to get the whole picture when we only have a little bit of information. We don't have all the information when it comes to this part of the prayer that you and I have been saying for decades. But regardless of that doxology, it may not be Jesus' exact words when he taught the disciples to pray that way, but yet it does fit because that type of ending is used throughout Scripture in other places. It's this form of praise that oftentimes was used to end prayers. And there's nothing wrong with saying that because, you know, we're not necessarily saying this is exactly what comes from Scripture. This is just we're using the Lord's prayer this way, and we include that at the end because it's powerful. For thine is the kingdom. Thine is the power. Thine is the glory forever. For yours is the kingdom. God's. It's God's kingdom. It's God's power. And it's God's glory forever. And I need that because, you know, what's assumed there? I need to say that because what's assumed there is it's not mine. It's never been mine. It's never been, ever was part of mine, and it never will be. That's what the forever kind of means in there, but I need to be reminded that. And I think that is Jesus' way of teaching us that, again, our tendency is to think differently when we pray, because we often want to think about, you know, as I pray indirectly, I think about my kingdom and my power and my will and ultimately my glory. Though that self-centeredness seems to sneak into our lives and into our prayer lives. And you know, when I think about this, that part about kingdom and power and glory, the reason I think it's so fitting, whether or not it was Christ's direct words or not, is I think it is sort of a parallel or a repeat to the opening part of the prayer. You know, when we say, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, and your will be done." Because look at those side by side here. You know, for thine is the kingdom is the first part of that doxology. But that's what we pray at the beginning. We pray, "Thy kingdom come." And then we also say at the end, "For yours is the power." But at the beginning we said, "It's your will, it's your power, it's your will that's being done." Very, very parallel kind of statement there. And it's your glory forever. And in the very first part of that prayer, we said, you know, it's your name we want to glorify. It's your name that is hallowed. So there is a similarity there. You know, the opening and the closing part of that prayer, they do go together very, very well. The first part's a little bit different though, because, you know, that's a petition. We are asking God. We are petitioning to Him. May your name be hallowed. May your kingdom come. May your will be done here and is in heaven as well. That's our request when we pray. That's the first request that we make to God. We close the prayer with the similar ideas, but it's not so much a request. What's different there? We're making a statement, and even more than that, we're making a statement of praise. That's what doxology really means. We're ending this prayer with praise. We praise you because all of this is about your kingdom. All of this is about your power. And all of this is about your glory. And again, I'm glad that idea is in there twice because I'm such a self-centered jerk. And I need to hear it so often because I want to get it back to myself instead of getting myself in the position that I need to be where He is God and I simply am not. So I kind of view this, the opening and the closing of the prayer, that doxology, they're sort of like bookends, and that wasn't a good way to think about it. I thought it was more like a sandwich. It's like a BTL sandwich is what we're gonna call this thing, where I remember things by food better, so I thought we could think about the the model of the Lord's Prayer in regards to a not a BLT, but it's a BTL, close sandwich. We begin and end the prayer, that model that he told us, with the focus on him. He is in heaven apart from us, but yet we're brought near. And we focus on, again, those two pieces of the bread that you can see here, the doxology on the right and the opening on the left, where we're focusing on his kingdom, his will, his power, his name, and his glory. Those are the two buns, if you will, of the sandwich. And then in the inside of that prayer, again, if we're thinking about Jesus teaching us to pray in this manner, we've got the start of the sandwich there. The inside of that prayer are three more types of petitions that we use in our model. Bread, B. Give us this day our daily bread. And then we got trespasses, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, or debts and debtors, depending on how you lead that. And to be led not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Those are the inner petitions, or the parts of those of that sandwich that we can help remember as we pray in this manner. Pray like this, Jesus says. And you know, those inner requests, those petitions, the B and the L and the T there, they are requests. But I think as I pray through this, and as I model this prayer that Jesus taught us, I think they also serve as reminders and way to highlight things that we need. As I pray through those requests, I'm reminded about things that I need to confess, or things that I need to be doing differently. And that's the beauty of praying this way, as things come to mind, I believe through the Spirit as we pray, that need to be brought to him. We do request daily bread kind of stuff, life and sustenance for this physical body, the basic things that we need to exist and to be, just to be human, come from him each day. And that prayer, when we pray through that, it reminds us to daily be thankful for all the awesome stuff, the necessity things that we have. And also it reminds me to acknowledge how dependent I am on him for every breath and every tick of the heartbeat. All of those are from him. But it's not just about, it's so important to pray for these things that I need for my physicality, my physical being. But that's not all of me. Remember the story when Jesus was taken into the wilderness for 40 days, and he was, Scripture says, he was led there to be tempted. And he was there 40 days. We only get to hear about three of them. But no doubt he was probably tempted much more than that. But we were allowed to share in three of those experiences. And if you remember from Matthew here, the tempter came and said to him, "Hey, if you really are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." He's been out there 40 days. He's probably hungry. And Satan knows he has power to turn stones into bread so he can have sustenance to satisfy this hunger, to allow himself to be fulfilled in his humanity. But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Christ tells us there that it's not, you know, your essence and your existence and your life, it's just not about the physical stuff. You don't live by just bread alone, but more than that, by the word that comes from the mouth of God. And later on, and we've talked about this a lot, is we find that he himself, the one that was tempted there, you and I, that's our bread. That is the bread for our spirits. In John 6, he says, "I am the bread of life." Your answers ate manna in the wilderness, they die. They were so jacked up because they got that free bread that rained down every night, and they ate it, and their tummies were full. But they still got hungry the next day, and even more than that, they still died. Their physical bodies still died. And Jesus says, "This is the bread that comes down from heaven." Me, I am the bread that comes down from heaven. So that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I give for the life of the world is my flesh. And so in as much as you and I pray, give us this day our daily bread, yeah, those things that we need shelter and we need food and we need safety and the other things that help us function in our system, yeah, we need those. But in as much as we ask for those, we need our spirits to be fed by Christ himself. He is that bread, and we take that bread when we receive his forgiveness. We're taking that bread when we take that forgiveness of our own sins, because that's what he offered to us. And we receive that bread also when we fully entrust our life to him. That is receiving that bread. And that's an ongoing thing, when we just give up a little bit more of ourselves and more fully entrust our lives to him. We take that bread that leads to life. We take that bread also when we live our lives in obedience to that which he commands. When we listen to the rest of his teachings, he says, you know, love your neighbor. Do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. When we obey that, we are taking that bread. That too is the daily bread that we need, which sustains our spirit, which is our real life that's found only in him. B, that's the bread. Boy, when you think through that and you pray through that in that manner, the Spirit will bring things to your mind that you can share with him and request of him. Now, the next one is dealing with our trespasses or our debts. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Well, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago. Part of that prayer, we've been forgiven, and part of that is to encourage us to also be people who forgive, and that is not in our nature. Pretty easy to hold grudges, pretty easy to, you know, hold on to anger because we've been wronged. And part of that prayer is about that. Forgive us, Lord, as we forgive others. That's a big part of that prayer. But one of the things we didn't talk about is, you know, there's a little bit of tension in that statement. Because we also know this from the book of Hebrews, the writer says, but this man, Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. That's in our faith. You and I know that because of what happened on that cross one time, that when I receive that forgiveness, that takes care of my sins then, now, and also in the future. My sins are covered there. And so it's kind of curious, isn't it, that, you know, my sins are covered. I have been forgiven. But why is it then that Jesus teaches us that we should seek forgiveness again? There is this one, there's a one and doneness to the penalty of sin, no doubt. It's over. And you and I stand, when we received Christ, we stand perfected in God's eyes. It is then done by faith when we have received him that forgiveness is taken care of. So why is it that we should pray for forgiveness again? We do, you and I, we stand perfected before God's throne. And I read this, and I just want to share this quote I read. I thought it was written very well. The forgiveness that we seek when we pray that prayer, it's not for pardon from an angry judge. That's already been taken care of. Forgive my sins here. I'm not looking for pardon from an angry judge, because it's already been done. But rather we pray for mercy from a grieved father. When we live life that is counter to him and we break down and we miss the mark and we sin, we're still purified and perfected because of Christ's blood in terms of judgment from the Father. But we seek this different relationship from him because we've grieved him. When we do sin, what happens there is it hinders the process of our own growth. You know, if you go on in that Hebrews passage, it's probably the favorite Bible verse in Scripture for all of me, because it says, therefore, by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. And I love that passage because it comes to the cross and it says, by that one sacrifice, these people who have received him have been forever perfected. Judiciously, as we stand before the throne of God, we're perfected, and that's what he sees. But it goes on to say, for those who are being made holy. You and I are in this process of becoming. That is what being a Christian is. It's this transformative discipleship kind of thing, that I'm going from an old version of me to a newer version of me that's never going to find completion until I'm dead or he returns. And we are being sanctified, or we are in this transformative process of becoming more and more like him. And that author is saying there that, you know, when you sin, you're busting up that process. You're keeping yourself from becoming the version of you that you are supposed to be. So as followers of Christ, again, as we pray this, as we model after this, and we think about during that time of the prayer, no doubt when we start using the word trespasses and debts and the need for forgiveness, the Spirit will bring things to your mind that need forgiven. And that's exactly how it's supposed to work. What is it that I did today that was hurtful? What is it that I did today that was off the mark? And that is how we are supposed to be. We should have then remorse over sin. We confess those daily to him, and we have this continual attitude once we know it, once we confess it, but then turn from it. That's what repentance is to turn from that and to turn to a life that leads more in life line with a healthy Christian living. That's just part of this process that you and I will go on and on daily, but boy, do we want to deny, don't we? Kind of hard to come before the throne and say, forgive us our sins, but then but don't tell me what they are. Easy to do. But if you take the time and pray in that manner and give him time to reveal to you what it is that you need to confess, he'll do it. So that, too, that trespass, that forgiveness part is part of this BTL sandwich that we talk about here as a model by which we can pray. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. You know, it's pretty easy to be kind of on this straight and narrow and hang out with you guys here on Sunday morning for about 20 minutes here. It's pretty easy to do. But, you know, as soon as we get out there and what happens up here, there's just so many things that are vying for your attention and for your very being and for your very soul, trying to steer you away from him and that which is right as determined by his right ways. We're tempted in so many ways. You turn on the television, you have a conversation with somebody, so many ways that you and I are tempted. James says this about temptation, which is pretty graphic but so real. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. Then, when that desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And that sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. It gives birth to death. What a strange statement. But that is exactly the consequences of sin. It just leads to death. And so that part of our prayer is to acknowledge that our weakness that we all have, that we have this lure, this prone to wander, this desire to just get away from his right ways. And we use that part of the prayer to acknowledge that. And then, again, acknowledge our dependence on him, that we, when we fall, need his deliverance. Pray in this manner, Jesus says. And again, the manner might be thought of as that sandwich. You know, you'll think of it now. It's food. It's a little helpful model there for you. Father, we're far away from you. You're in heaven, but yet we can come to you. That's what the first statement says, and how awesome that is, that we get to participate in heaven every time we call your name, our Father. And we are also focused when we pray using that model, that it's not just about my request, you know, just give me the numbers for the winning lottery, help me score well at the golf tournament, whatever, you know. It isn't about us. Those buns of the sandwich tell me it's about you. It's about your great name. It's about your kingdom and your will being accomplished. I'm reminded to ask him to give us just what we need today, and to be mindful and thankful for all that he does and all the good things that come from him. And we stop and we talk about forgiveness. And we can stop right there and just give him praise for hours about his forgiveness of us. But when I'm talking about forgiveness, it's an awesome time for me to think of two things. What is it in my life that needs forgiven, and confess it? And the second thing when I'm thinking about and praying for forgiveness is, who do I need to forgive? Who in my life have I wronged and needs my forgiveness? And also then, if I think about that prayer, I can go right to the sticky stuff and think about how I am tempted and tried, and pray for his shield and his protection that so lures me in the wrong way. So I'd like for you to take that sandwich home with you this week. I'd like for you to think a little bit about the Lord's Prayer and prayer in general, and perhaps use that as a model as you pray. You know, I don't know of any other time in my life, probably. I'm going to be 59 soon. And I don't know of any other time in my life that there's probably not been a need for prayer. With what's going on in culture, what's going on in our families, what's going on in our world, what's going on in the church in general, stuff needs fixing. And I just don't think it's going to be a government that's going to do it. And I just don't think it's going to be some sort of technology, or it's going to be some sort of humanitarian group that's going to come together and fix us like we need fixed. I think it's going to come through the church. And I think it's going to come when the church begins to pray and to seek God's mercy and his grace and his help and his movement in our world. In your bulletin towards the end, I just rattled off a few things that we need to be praying for. And I want us to do that this week. There's several things in there. The first thing I had in there is pray for you. I'll let you be self-centered here a little bit. Start off by praying for yourself and those around you, or someone around you that you know. Pray for our world and what we're going through. The reality of it, I know we're on different ends of the spectrum. You know, how real is the pandemic? And well, the sure reality of it is that it is for sure affecting the world, and no doubt it needs fixed. And I think the only way it's going to get fixed is when God makes a move. Our government definitely needs our prayers. A couple other things I'd like for you to focus on, particularly this week, as you use the sandwich model. One is, I mentioned before, for in announcements, our leadership team, our executive board, is going to get together here, and they're going to meet a few times here in the next few weeks to kind of think a little bit about church, kind of think a little bit about Pleasant Chapel. You know, I think we're in a unique time here, that we're kind of coming through some unique times, and yet there is this world that so needs this church. And I'd ask the whole congregation to be praying for that leadership as they make some decisions about what is it we should be doing as a church, that we could just share the good news of Christ with more people in our communities. And finally, I got a heart for our kids. You know, they're back to school. And I know a lot of us will think, well, boy, they got it easier. Just a kid, he's going to go to school. But let me tell you, being an educator for a lot of years, and also listening to the stories that are coming from Whitco through my wife about what's happening with all the changes here, it's tough being a kid. It's tough being a student. It's difficult. They've got, you know, our students are making career decisions on what they're going to do after high school, and yet they're being bombarded by so many voices that, I'll tell you, are not consistent with what this teaches. And I think it's our job as their family members, you know, as we vowed to do that as their church people, to lift them up in prayer. So yeah, I'm a teacher. I just gave you some homework. I'd like for us to do just that, because I think you and I live in a time where we need prayer. We need prayer for so many things, and I just know the power of that, and I look forward to see God moving in this family and in this community by which he's going to do through this church. Amen? All right. How about we stand and we do just that? We close with prayer. Father, we just thank you for who you are, that you are our God. We thank you that this family this group that you drew together today is yours. We are your people. And we are your people who just seek to just relinquish the things that we so hold on to, like our own will and our way and our kingdom and our glory. And we give that over to you, and we want to be a people who are all about your kingdom and your glory and fulfilling your will. We just so look forward to being your participants in that. You have so blessed all of us with that which we do need. And we are grateful for that. Keep us, through your Spirit, hungry for your Son as we'd open up Scripture this week and look for Him there. Ask, Lord, that you would guard our hearts, because we are a people that have weaknesses. I'd ask that you would shield us from the things that tempt us and lure us away from you. And when we fall, we are grateful for the forgiveness that you give us. Lord, allow us to move from here safely as your people to do your work this week, that your kingdom may grow through the encounters we would have with people that cross our paths. We praise you and give you the glory, all in your Son's name. Amen. Y'all be safe, and we'll see you here next week.
So many times I haven't been true. Kept myself from you, didn't know I could be honest. I thought you'd walk away.